I work for a company called Rebel Alliance, or I guess I own a company called Rebel Alliance, which, if you notice on the program, is one of the sponsors of this event. I don't normally speak at this kind of event, but we really wanted to be involved in this. We think that open source is a really important question. We think that it's changing the way that work is done, and we want to be in support of it as much as possible. So everything that we can do that our clients will allow us to open source, we do. So our website is available open source. Our contracts that we sign with our customers, we've put online open source so people can reuse them. We have the book that this talk is based on is available open source on GitHub. You can contribute to it, even as a continuous delivery pipeline. So it's about 2 minutes from the moment I accept your pull request to it being updated on LeanPub and a new version being available, which we're pretty happy about. Really, I've only gotten some grammar corrections so far, if I'm being totally honest. There hasn't been a lot of like real tools contributed. But so we think it's an important thing and we wanted to be involved. So I wasn't even sure anybody was going to show up, frankly. So I guess I want to just start out by getting to know you guys a little bit. How many of you work in organizations or companies that are at least paying lip service to the term Agile? Okay, good. So I really wasn't sure, but I figured that. Yeah, lip service is, you know, you're doing this Scrum thing and everybody's got to make sure that they report everything upward the line really well, and there's lots of very strict rules to follow. And some of you might be working in different organizations. I'll get into that in just a minute. That's a little bit of the why I wrote this actual book in the first place. But I'm not going to waste a lot of time telling you about myself. That's me. You can tell. I'm wearing the same clothes pretty much. You can learn more about me on Rebel Alliance. It is important for the purposes of the talk that you believe I have some idea what I'm talking about. So rather than waste a bunch of time convincing you of that, we're just going to make a simple agreement in this room. Let's just agree that I'm amply well qualified to talk about this. Yeah? Everybody's good on that? Excellent. I do briefly want to mention this one. I mention this in every talk. Scrum Beers is a group I started, me and some friends, about 7 or 8 years ago now. I know I've met some people in this room before there. But we started out about 7 or 8 years ago. We were four friends sitting around getting drunk and complaining about our jobs. And now we are, I checked this morning, we are 1,067 members in Gothenburg. And we have chapters in 3 other cities at the moment. So we're extremely proud of that. It's an open brand. People are allowed to start their own chapters wherever they are. The only rule that we have is that you make it free for people to attend. So. Oh yeah, right, there's one other very important thing I need to mention about myself. Despite the fact that you can't tell, I'm Canadian and not American. That seems to be getting increasingly more important to make clear as time goes on. So everybody's got that now, good. So I want to start just really quickly on why I wrote this book and why I made this talk in the first place. I started out, I guess, about 10 years ago now as a Scrum Master. I went on the 2-day course. I came back. It was going to change the world. Boy, how naive I was. I got back. I did everything that the book told me to do. I put the burndown charts on the wall. I asked people how many points were left on their things. I updated the charts. I moved the post-it notes around. And surprise, surprise, it wasn't really all that successful. And, you know, the more I read about this topic, the more it talked about, you know, you have to try other things, you have to experiment, you have to approach things differently. But when I went on the internet, all I found was people parroting the same stuff over and over and over and over again. And what I found was that when the burndown charts and the poker planning failed you, there really wasn't anywhere else to go. So I struggled through that for a lot of years. My first company I worked with eventually went out of business, which, while I don't recommend it from an emotional standpoint, is a tremendous learning experience. And I went through a couple more teams, and eventually I started to find patterns and things that were successful for me. Some of them successful here and not successful there, but eventually I started to develop a toolkit that benefited me in certain situations, and so I wanted to share that with people. Standard disclaimer slide. I don't have a magic bullet. I don't have the perfect answer. A lot of this is meant as inspiration. Take this and use it to make your own tools. Try some of it out, but please don't religiously follow this the way that I did the burndown charts and the poker planning, because that's not the point. It's meant to be as inspiration. So let's jump into it then. So a couple of tools. This is really just a collection of different things that I use. Experiment-driven change. How many of you have retrospectives at the moment? Okay, how many of you have seen anything change as a result of them? Not as many as we would like. Retrospective is an extremely powerful tool. I've had great success with them for, I would say, the last 5 or 6 years, but I spent many years having very unproductive ones. Until a friend of mine, Ulla Berg, who some of you might know, introduced me to a pattern that really helped change the way I look at this, and that eventually developed into this tool that I call experiment-driven change. So, what we usually do when we're having retrospectives is a pattern that that my friend Ulla calls coffee room whining. I'm sure you guys don't do this, but maybe you've seen your colleagues do this from time to time, right? We sit around, we have a fika, we have a little complaint about what's going on at work, and then everybody goes back to their desk. So I'm going to define coffee room whining a little bit more specifically so it's easy to identify when it's happening, and then I'll talk about how we can try to get out of that pattern. So the first symptom of coffee room whining is we talk about absolutely everything that's wrong in our organization. And I've worked with companies all throughout this city and a few around the world. Doesn't matter how large they are, the big ones across the water here, doesn't matter if it's 2,000 people in a building, we know everything that's wrong with the organization, which is obviously really helpful of us. The second thing is, after we identify all the stuff that's wrong in the organization, we invariably find that it's somebody else's fault. Now, it sounds like I'm being sarcastic here. I'm actually not, really. You guys are adults. You like your jobs for the most part. You don't allow things to be wrong just to be jerks, right? It probably is somebody else's fault. But unfortunately, that's not a really great attitude for helping us address the problem. And then what happens is we finish the fika, we go back to our desk, and absolutely nothing changes as a result of the discussion we've just had. That's actually not entirely true. There's a slight change. We are ever so slightly more bitter than we were before we had the coffee room whining session. So there is some change, but not really the change that we're hoping for. So this is how, and if you're doing this, you can really easily identify it. You'll come up with 15 or 20 things in a retrospective. You will hand those off to a scrum master or manager. You'll say, fix this. And you'll come back 2 or 3 weeks later, and you'll have the exact same discussion over again. And you do that over and over and over and over again until months, years go by, and finally somebody plucks up the courage to say, why do we keep doing this? This, nothing has ever changed as a result, which is perfectly fair. So then I was taught a pattern that was really helpful for me, was to see retrospectives as the exact opposite of coffee room whining. So instead of focusing on everything that's wrong, we talk about one thing. We focus on only one point. Whatever the biggest problem we have today is, we focus on that. We do this for a few reasons. One, it's really demotivating to talk about absolutely everything that's wrong. But also problems in organizations, they tend to be quite interlinked with each other. One thing kind of feeds the other. So say we talked about 10 and we solved the first one, well, the other 9 might not be relevant anymore, and we spend a lot of time and energy discussing something that's no longer useful, right? So focus on one thing. Then we always talk about what we can do about it. No matter what issue you're facing, and I don't, did I, nope, oh. We'll just pretend that didn't happen. No matter what issue you are facing, there's always one of three things you can do about it. In the ideal scenario, you can fix it. This doesn't happen as often as we might like it to happen, because as we said, it's probably somebody else's fault. But occasionally, you can do a root cause analysis so you can find a way to fix the actual issue. A lot more frequently than that, we can find ways to minimize the issue. We can put systems or processes in place that reduce its impact on us. And no matter what the issue is, no matter what it is, there's one thing we can always, always, always do, is we can bring more visibility to it. We can inform people about it, we can talk about it, we can find ways of visualizing it, we can bring that problem more to the surface so that it becomes more obvious and gets harder to ignore. In large hierarchies, we promote people based on their ability to not bring problems to the people above them. That's a great employee to have, right? This person comes along, they just solve everything. Nothing ever happens. When we do the coffee room whining, we make the assumption that the people above us know that there's a problem. You'd be very surprised how rarely this is the case. We've been trained over many, many years to not bring problems to the surface, to sweep them under the rug, or to ignore them. How many of you have had the discussion, yeah, well, that's just the way it works here. I know it's terrible, but, you know, it's just the way it works here. What we're trying to do is we're trying to bring these things to the surface, make them more obvious, make them harder to ignore so we can actually deal with them. And then finally, the big difference between a retrospective and, say, a project postmortem, which is just the worst title ever, right? It's The project is dead, and now we're going to perform an autopsy to figure out why it died. The big difference between a retrospective and those is, because we have them with such frequency, because they're happening every 2 weeks, for example, we don't need to find the perfect solution to the problem. All we need to do is figure out experiments that we can perform. It's only a 2 week period. There's only so much that can go wrong in 2 weeks, right? You guys familiar with that? That's the, I'm saying something I shouldn't say now. There's only so much that can go wrong in 2 weeks, right? If we can find good experiments, we don't need to spend months and weeks, and let's be honest, this is Sweden, organized committees to debate what the best possible solution to an issue is. We can just try stuff out. We can say, let's see what happens over the next 2 weeks. We'll follow it up, and then we'll see if it's had any effect. And this is what experiment-driven change is about. A little hard to read. It doesn't really matter. This is just sort of a format to get you started. This is by no means a silver bullet. I'll keep reiterating that as we go forward. But look at what the symptom is, whatever it is we're seeing. Talk a little bit about what the root cause is. This is a pretty common example, right? Too many interruptions. Anybody ever experienced that at work? Yeah. Too many meetings. People keep coming up and saying, can I bother you for 1 second? You already did. And then, you know, when we dig a little bit more into it, we see that, you know, we see a lot of support requests. That's one of the big causes of interruptions. And, you know, what causes that? Well, a lot of bugs in production, for instance, causes that. We don't get time from our product owner to fix them. They won't let us fix it. We got a little bit into the blaming somebody else area there. But then we talk a little bit more about that, and we say, you know, maybe they don't see them as a high priority. Well, you know, we're not really doing a great job of motivating why these things are a high priority. We're not convincing them. They know why new features are important, right? We need to help them understand why bugs are important, too. So an experiment in this example is start visualizing and tracking the cost of supporting bad quality. That's a pretty easy thing to do. How often do we get interrupted? How much does it take away from our regular work? How much do we invest in it? You don't need exact numbers. And we add an ROI field to each bug. This is just an example, of course. Then we have an important part here is some sort of success criteria. We are trying to perform experiments here. I'm being a little liberal in the use of the word experiment. I mean, this is not from a scientific perspective, an experiment, but if you just don't call me on that, it'll work, I promise. Here we have a success criteria, at least 2 bugs prioritized in each sprint. That's how we know this experiment worked. We have a follow-up interval, 4 weeks, we're going to follow it up, and we have somebody who drives it, which is U1, which is always the safest name to go with in Sweden, right? If I don't know the name of somebody, I just guess that. I just like, why not? That's 50-50, I'm going to be right. I used to say how many U1s in the room, but I'm not going to do that. And this is a really simple thing. You can get through this in 45 minutes and you have a really solid experiment. Do I know that this is going to work? No, I have absolutely no idea. But it's 4 weeks of our life, and we're going to follow it up. And if that doesn't work, then we're going to have something else. It's a lot easier to make the argument, can I just try this for a little bit? We call these safe-to-fail experiments. It's a lot easier to motivate to your manager why, okay, I'll get real outrageous, why we should stop using points when estimating things. It's a lot easier to do that if you can say, but what if we just tried it for 3 weeks? Can you give me 3 weeks to try this out? This is what experiment-driven change is all about. It's a great tool for moving this stuff forward. And that was experiment-driven change. Appreciation flowers. When I was getting this ready this morning, I noticed a fun one. This is just a tool for retrospectives. This is a fun one. I've kind of intermingled fun ones with more powerful ones. These are really just something you put up. The fun thing I noticed, one of this is my ex. Apparently I haven't really removed that from the book yet. It's a little awkward. Appreciation flowers are a real simple tool. At your retrospective, you draw a little flower, you put it up on the wall, and you tell somebody in your team something they did for you that you appreciated this last week. Helps build a really nice sort of vibe in the team, helps people feel appreciated for the work they did. I've even seen like arms races develop where people start to draw nicer and nicer flowers. I can't draw nice flowers. You can see these are the height of the, you know, the last one. That's the best one I can possibly do there. But it's really nice, and I like to tell a story about one time I was there when I worked for Federproof, that's Trafikverket, where you get your licenses. I worked there for about 2 years. I had a teammate, and she put one up for me, and when she said what it was, she said, yeah, well, I think that nobody ever comments on the job that you're doing because it's pretty much invisible, but I really feel that there's an impact of it and I really appreciate it and it's making my life easier. And I almost cried a little bit. It was really nice. So that's just a quick fun one. Tasty time boxes is another fun one. I guess how many working in sprints at the moment? Yeah, so you have a time cycle, right? And some of you find that you may need to refer to those time cycles in the past tense. When we developed this feature, was in sprint 1.4 or whatever it is. Tasty time box is a real simple tool for referring to stuff in the past tense. You pick something that is tasty, sweets, fruits, cheeses, etc. I've used cakes in the past. I was very fond of that one. You name every sprint alphabetically, so the first one is Eppelkocka, and the second one is Blåbärs pie, or whatever it is. You name them with that, and then you... Oh, I already had something up there, look at that. And then you eat it at the sprint review. It's actually more, thanks. It's actually a more powerful tool than it sounds. This is, again, something we used when I worked at Trafikverket. And, you know, we would have our customer, we were consultants, and our customer would come in for our sprint review every 2 weeks, and we would show them the stuff that we did. And then immediately after that, we would sit and we would have fika together, right? Sorry, is anybody not from Sweden? Should I just be throwing fika around? Everybody knows what fika is. Good. And we would sit and we would have a fika together and we would build a good relationship and we would learn to communicate with each other better. I even have a little bit of a theory that there was some sort of Pavlovian response being built there because people were getting sweets at the end of the thing, that they were learning to appreciate the sprint review more. I have no actual data, total pseudoscience on that, but and enjoy. Bugs for breakfast. This is a really good one that I've been really happy with. I guess I've used in the last four or five teams I've worked in. It's a tool for building quality in teams. Have a team breakfast each week, say 1.5 hours. Currently we use 2 hours. We do it on Thursdays every week. Focus on quality related things at the team breakfast. You can look at error logs, you can improve your logging, you can improve tooling around it, you know, getting better quality. You can actually sit and fix issues. We did this for quite a while at my current place. We sat around and we did mob programming groups and actually just addressed bugs that we found on the backlog during this time and then got them out to production as quickly as possible. Creating tests, whatever it might be. Anything that increases quality. The main point here is making quality top of mind. There's a little bit of an anti-pattern that can develop where you start only worrying about quality during these 1 or 2 hours a week. This is not something I recommend, but it's a really good mechanism for giving yourself a little bit of breathing room. If you're in one of these, we're constantly fighting fires environments, and it never feels like you get to address the root cause of stuff. This is just putting aside a little bit of time to sort of lower the pressure, build stuff of a really high quality, and prevent it from coming next time. And socialize, obviously. Most of my tools involve socialization. I think it's one of the keys to work. Also one of the reasons I love living and working in Sweden. This seems to be a country that appreciates that. Maybe a little too much sometimes, but... Fika. I mean, I think I make fun of fika, but I do think fika is a brilliant institution. I do. Where does the time go? Anybody find they have too many meetings? You find yourself saying that a lot and it not really changing? Find yourself mostly complaining about it? Where does the time go is a really great tool for helping to motivate that type of thing. It's really simple. You just put something up on the wall or you can have it personally at your desk. This is not about specific time tracking. This example here is actually for an entire team. And we're really just asking for round numbers. A tick represents an hour. It's not, you know, it's not very specific. And if you only work six hours during the day, then only tick off 6 points. It's not about figuring out what people do, but what it's about is seeing where we actually put time into stuff. And then if it does turn out that for every, I don't know the actual numbers, 13 hours of planned work, we're doing 25 hours of meetings, well, now I have a really good motivation of why we need to change that dynamic because I have some actual data on this. I have some information I can show and make the argument for. It's again about bringing that problem to the surface and making it more visual. Or when I often find my team is complaining we do too much administration, and it turns out we're really not doing a lot of administration. You can learn stuff about yourself here, too. I mean, I know we all hate administration, but if it's 2 hours for all this kind of stuff, then maybe it's not as big a deal as we thought it was. So this is a really simple tool. We just look every morning and we just kind of go, yeah, this is what yesterday looked like. And then once a week we compile the results and we get a nice little pie chart because managers like pie charts. And then we have something to sort of motivate the things that we want to argue with. Event log. This is a tool for retrospectives, really handy one. Has anybody read Thinking Fast and Slow? It's a great book, highly recommended for anybody who hasn't, but they talk a lot about a cognitive bias in that, where we tend to make things that happened recently more important than things that happened before them. And they see this in retrospectives all the time. We always talk about the last 4 days, never about the week and a half or 2.5 weeks that came before that. Whatever happened in the last 4 days was always the most important thing that happened. Event logs are a really simple tool to try to counteract that. Basically, every morning at our daily, we just write down the date and we just write down a quick, what happened yesterday? Was there any important events yesterday? So that when we come to the retrospective, we have a sort of timeline of what actually took place during the 10 minutes. Okay. We have a sort of timeline of what actually took place during the thing, so that we remember the stuff that actually happened. That, you know, on the first day of the sprint, there were 40 support requests that we forgot about because servers were rebooting later on, right? And we can just have a little bit more of an idea of what's really going on. Door calendar. I've never ceased to be amazed with the fact that we can be surprised by things that happen repetitively over and over and over again. Like, teams I work with, it's like, oh, is it the sprint review tomorrow? It's like, it's the sprint review every second Thursday. Is this not easy to keep track of? Or there's other stuff that happens. There's unknown events or things that you don't, you know, they happen irregularly or whatever. Door calendar, really handy tool, really handy information radiator for keeping track of that. It's just got days of the week. It's about 6 weeks out, so you can go and sort of see what's happening in the future. Got a little legend to show stuff. So here we have things that happen irregularly. So we have a lawn party happening on Thursday, a production deployment happening down here, specific ceremonies that we have, days off, things like that. We just put them up, and then every morning we move this little today counter, and everybody just glances at the thing for 2 seconds. That's all it takes. You move the little today counter, and everybody goes, huh, oh, next week is Easter, maybe we should plan less work, because Easter's coming up. Actually, this was made like 2 years ago. It's just a coincidence that Easter was last week. It's really super easy, super quick, super simple tool for just seeing that people can see what's coming up into the future. Morning meeting protocol. Who loves their morning meeting? Ah, no. Who loves their morning meeting? That's more people than I expected were going to raise their hands. The team I work in currently is the only team I've ever worked in where our morning meeting feels useful and productive. I've been in 15 teams probably, and it's always arduous and painful. And it always feels like, what are we trying to do? We started using something, this is just one of the things that contributes, but we started using something we call the morning meeting protocol. We've been super happy with. It's just a slideshow that we go through every morning. We put it up on the screen and we go through it one slide at a time. You don't have to read all the stuff up here, but it basically says to us, what are the points that are important to cover? So that we remain focused on those points. We're not drifting off into this conversation and that conversation. We're talking about one thing at a time. Calendar. What meetings did team members attend yesterday? Any actions for the team from those things? Do we have any meetings today? Do you need anyone for them? Is there anything we have being delayed by meetings? Boom, 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 boom. We go through it, we move on to the next thing. This slide usually takes us 30 seconds. New actions, production issues, emails that came in, anything from our chat rooms, any unplanned work that happened. I'm not going to go through all of these, but you get the general idea. We just go through these things one thing at a time. It keeps us really focused on what's important to talk about. It also moves us away from the reporting style of things. I can send this out and you can get the actual text. It moves us away from the reporting style of things. What did you do yesterday? What are you going to do today? Those aren't the important questions, right? This is about a team coordinating, about figuring out what they do. This is what it looked like for us about, I guess, a month and a half ago. Now all of these things have become so routine that half of this is gone. I think we're down to 3 slides with like 2 or 3 points on each of them. We're always changing it and updating it. If we find things slip through the cracks, then we're adding those on there so that we're sure to talk about them. If we find things are getting repetitive and we get the same answer every day, then we're removing things from it. It's a really quick and easy tool for keeping things succinct. And big recommendation here is around the parking lot. We are ruthless in the parking lot. As soon as somebody feels for half a second like this is becoming relevant, they yell, parking lot. Somebody jots it down, we come back to that at the end, and people are free to leave if they don't think it's important. A few other handy things, planned absences, who's not going to be here, who's vubbing today, these types of questions. Reminding of us of our experiments we should be doing, that's something we do every day. Is there something we're supposed to be doing today that we agreed to in our retrospective? I'm sure some of you have experienced that. Well, we go to the retrospective and then we say all the stuff and we come back 3 weeks later. It turns out we didn't do any of the stuff we said we were going to do. So these types of things, they just kind of keep us in check. They remind us of these simple, both simple housekeeping tasks and keep us on point. 5 minutes left. I'm going to skip the last tool. This one I'll still talk about. Anybody here using Kanban? There's a few. One of the big problems I've encountered when using Kanban, which I'm a huge fan of, is the idea of when we hit our work in process limits. Work in process limits, for anybody that doesn't know, is a number that we have that says we're not allowed to have any more than this amount of work in process at any given point in time. One of the big problems I've always encountered is when we hit those, team members are then saying, well, what am I going to do? I'm not just going to sit on my hands, right? So they start more work, which is exactly the point that we're trying to get away from with the work in process limit. I had a team member once, he stacked the tasks on the book because we had a physical board. He just taped them to one another, and so they appeared as one task, but if you took them off, they went... And it's a fair point, right? Do I just stop working because we've hit some arbitrary number that we wrote on a board? No, that's not what this is about. A work in process limit is about making us stop and think and reflect and find ways to improve. So a WIP protocol is really good at just saying, what sort of discrete steps do I go through when I hit the WIP limit so that I know exactly what I should do? Have some coffee, I should take that off there. I don't know why it's up there. Try to unblock any blocked items. See if anyone can finish halted work out in that we use mob programming, so that's a little specific to us. We have a tech swim lane, also a little specific to us. Hold a retro focused on blocked items. How can we prevent blocked items from happening in the future? Always focus on always started work, and then it always ends with start something new with the team's permission. So at that point, when we say, okay, we've exhausted the other options, then we'll start something new. We'll do a one-off and break our rules. This is really the only important one. This is the last point on your WIP protocol. Your team can have a discussion about what all the rest of these points mean for them. We have three teams in the place I'm currently at. They all have different WIP protocols, what they do, what priority they do them in. Some of them don't have this retro thing, for example. Lots of them don't have to have a coffee. It's kind of an old one. I don't think ours says that anymore. But it's really just about making us stop and focus and think about the thing before we pull more work in. Okay, I thought I was almost done. Not now, backlog. How many of you have thousands of items on your backlog? Yeah, can't even see it. There's a mess of stuff. Somebody might need that someday. People are going to get angry if we close the thing. That's a classic one, right? I'm never going to do it. I know I'm never going to do it, but I know somebody's going to get pissed when I close this bug that they think should be fixed. So not now, backlog's a great tool for dealing with that. Define what now means for you. Is it the next 6 months? Is it the next 3 months? What does now mean? Create a deep backlog. Call it a deep backlog, because then it's like, yeah, basically you create something where you don't see the rest of it, right? We call it not now in my team. And then move everything you're not going to do there. That's all there is to it. Really straightforward. Just move all the stuff there. Leave it open. I should say, to be fair, I would prefer if you close the things. I think it's stupid that we have this. My team doesn't use this anymore. We close stuff ruthlessly. If we're not going to do it in the next 3 months, the next 6 months, we're never going to do it. If it's important, it's going to come back up. How many important things have you seen people stop talking about forever? That doesn't happen, right? So if you are in the type of environment where you don't have to do this, don't do this. But if you're in the type of environment where people are going to get upset when you start to close things that you're never going to do, not now backlog is a great tool for that. And then forget about it. I have never, this is my fourth team I've used this in, I have never gone into the not now backlog to retrieve something, ever. It's never happened to me. I'm sure we've done some stuff that's in there, but that's because somebody brought it up again, and then we talked about it again. And then this was the last one. I'm going to skip this because it's a bit longer. I guess my timing was a little bit off, so just you can get... You can find out more on my book. Shameless plug. I forgot paper copies because we were supposed to be here at 7:30 in the morning and I wasn't paying attention. I have some paper copies at home. If you give me your info, I can mail you one. But you can't buy the physical copies at the moment. Only I have them. But you can get them completely free on a pay-what-you-like model on LeanPub. Actually, a few months ago, I'm very proud of this, somebody paid $1,000 for this book, even though they didn't have to pay anything. So that was pretty great. I have no idea who it was. It wasn't my mom. I checked. And my dad wouldn't do it, so I didn't bother checking it. So that's pretty much all I have. Thanks.
Awesome.
I left no time for questions, but it's lunch. Maybe we can run over 5 minutes if people have stuff.
I missed the first part. Where in Sweden are you based? Because
I am based in Malmö.
So in Gothenburg.
Yeah. So my current customer is called Meltwater. They have an office on Avenyn. I work as a consultant, so I work with them about 80%, and then I work with other organizations the rest of the time. Sorry.
Thank you.
One here. And one there.
Tips and tools which you have in this book are...
Hold that.
I think they want it for the camera, so you have to use the mic.
Tips and the tools which you have in this book, are those all from you, or have there been other tips and tricks from your colleagues?
I have stole relentlessly in this thing. I've stole from all kinds of people. I try to give credit wherever possible in the thing. The idea with making it open source is other people could try this and then they could contribute variations. Hasn't actually happened yet. But that's the long-term idea with it. So it's from a lot of people. Some of it is outright just stolen from other people. And I was like, this is good. People should know about this. So,
so there might be even version 2 coming out?
I hope so, yeah. Actually, so at the moment, I'm looking at doing another version, which is around specific workshops for specific purposes. And when I say I'm looking at it, I mean I have a whole bunch of ideas in my head and I've done nothing about it.
So thank you for a very interesting talk.
Yes.
I see a possible mode of failure in the first pattern, namely, how do you actually decide which one issue to discuss?
There's a lot of different methods for arriving at what one is the most important one. All of them have some different kinds of failure with them. Like you can use whatever has the most people commented on it, but just because the most people said something doesn't mean it's the most important. You can use dot voting as a really popular way to do it. At the end of the day, I think it's a lot more valuable to get started with anything than it is to sit around and debate what the most important thing is. It's a little bit more about not ignoring the one that is really important and everybody knows it's really important, which is what we usually end up doing, right? Well, we can never do anything about that. And I can tell you, I've worked with the government. I've heard this statement more times than I can. That's impossible. In the government, they do this great thing. The state does this great thing. They say, it's illegal. The government doesn't make laws about how you deploy software. That's not the type of, I mean, there are some. But, I mean, the government, laws are a very big thing. They take a really long time to make. Laws don't exist for all these little specific situations. So people say it's illegal, and then you start looking into it, and it turns out it's not really illegal, and it's just the way that people have been doing it for a really long time. And it's about overcoming those things, right? Overcoming the biases that we have, not just accepting the things that will never change, but saying, no, this has to change. We have to do something about that. I have a story about that, but I'm not going to tell it here. Anyone else?
I have a, if I may.
Jeff, thank you very much for a great talk, as usual. I have a question. Do you have any tips for distributed teams? Because more and more teams are working with people located in other countries and stuff like that. Have you had any experience?
Just don't count as a tip?
What's again?
Just don't count as a tip?
All right, that's a question.
No, it's... I think it's a fair question. I think it's something we're having a lot of difficulty tackling. I have a really difficult time with this. I'm very much a face-to-face person, right? That's how I operate. It's actually funny. So my girlfriend is moving here in 3 weeks from Canada to live for 3 months, and my mom called me last night, and she said, "How's Stacy? Is she coming to visit?" I said, "Visit? Yeah, she's moving here." My mom was like, "What? You didn't tell me this." Like, I don't communicate via text messages, right? Like, if I don't talk to her physically, then I don't let her know that apparently I've been planning for 6 months this big life event, and I don't mention it to people. Some of us really need the face-to-face environment to function. That being said, open source is a great example of where you do create virtual teams and are very successful with them, right? So I would, in one way, want to put the question back on you, but I think the main thing to keep in mind there is you really have to try to get to know people. It's not enough just to have them be names in a chat room. Lowering the barrier to communication as much as humanly possible. Getting on Hangouts. We tried it. One of my teams at the organization I'm currently at tried remote mob programming for a bit. They saw limited success with that. But you know, this idea of trying to see each other more, trying to speak to each other more. But I don't have any easy answers to that one. Meet people if at all possible, even if you're going to work with them remotely. I've worked with outsourced teams that we've had some success with in the past. I can say, don't throw it over the wall and wait for it to come back done. That definitely doesn't work. And we, it took a long time to build those relationships, right? To get to know people so that I knew who to call directly when I had an issue, and we knew it, we had good communication. But I don't have any easy answers for that. Anyone else? Thanks. Lunch. Oh yeah, and I have Windows. I shouldn't have. I actually get bullied at my work. I'm the only one who uses Windows.
You almost got to past you.
Yeah. I even full screened it before, so I didn't get caught.